So, okay, let's talk about this whole DIY underground scene. So what is the DIY underground scene? Because that was the first thing I had to like break through when I was reading the story. Because again, I wasn't familiar with the names of the bands. I have kind of dabbled in some of the, I looked some of them up on YouTube and actually wasn't that bad. I looked up the Buttertones. They have a song called Matador that I really like. And so I did delve into it a little bit, but how would you describe what the type of music that we're going to be talking about here?
So it's funny that you said, you know, DIY isn't kitchen fixing your kitchen sink, because so DIY, do it yourself, sort of stands for this sort of punk rock aesthetic where these bands weren't waiting for sort of mainstream acceptance. They were kind of doing everything themselves, to making their own flyers, to promoting themselves, to booking their own tours, to just kind of creating a world of music unto themselves that became hugely popular. So it's like, even if you haven't heard of these bands in the mainstream, the people who were involved in this scene, I mean, this was a way of life. So and that's a huge swath of people, you know, a lot of underground kids, kids who you know, identify with punk rock and indie rock and kind of an outsider ideal and aesthetic. And Burger Records really came to epitomize that for Southern California youth, and you know, and even people, you know, and part of the problem was a lot of the fans were young and a lot of the musicians were a lot older, in their 30s and 40s. You know, so that's where you kind of set up this sort of culture clash.
And so this, by the way, this scene still exists, right? I mean, we're talking about the rise and fall of one label, but the scene still goes on. And how big is it? I mean, like if you were to talk about it, like how much of the music spectrum does this whole indie, you know, underground scene?
I might have a stilted view of it because it's been such a large part of my life through the years, but it's huge. And you know, it's, you mentioned a band like Weezer, you know, Weezer came up in that world, or a band like Green Day, which right. is a massive band. They were sort of what any indie punk kid would be aspiring to be, like in the, you know, okay. 90s, they were coming up in driving around and their parents were driving them to shows in a van. You know, they were just like little punk rock kids who played little punk rock venues and they were skaters. So there are some massive bands that come out of this, you know, and so, you know, you get to the top, like bands like Green Day and Weezer, and then you get to the bottom, you know, with smaller bands, like you mentioned the Buttertones. Like they weren't huge, but they toured internationally. You know, mm-hmm. they probably got a couple hundred kids at their shows and could do that across the country. And that's no small feat for if you're a small, you know, a smallish non-major label band. So in some ways, the scene's pretty huge. It extends across the globe. I mean, there's kids all over South America, Europe, Asia, everywhere that love this music. Yep. So, you know, it, again, it speaks to kind of the sort of punk aesthetic, you know, the underground outsider punk aesthetic. So that extends kind of everywhere in some ways.
Where do they find the music? Because I'm finding, and I don't listen to the radio a lot anymore, but I don't know. I was thinking about it the other day, the demise of rock and, you know, how alternative kind of disappeared. And so where would you consume this music? Is it primarily a live product for the consumers?
That live is a huge part of it. And then like Burger released cassette tapes. I mean,
right.
What? Right?
Like, hold on, don't skip ahead. Yes, that, I want to talk about that because they had a very interesting business model. Yeah, right. So cassette tapes, right? So, yeah, it's the ultimate outsider deal, right?
Yeah, because these are for kids who didn't grow up with cassette tapes. You know, like these are kids who, you know, had to go out of their way to find a cassette tape player, because those aren't just anywhere anymore. You know, the parents probably told them about them, you know, so it was that gets to this sort of outsider thing, you know, vinyl, of course. I mean, vinyl is a huge thriving industry now, but it was pretty, you know, it's still niche, mm-hmm. but like mm-hmm. vinyl, cassettes, you know, and then of course, in this day and age, like YouTube and in social media, huge for these bands. Okay. You know, so you could release your own music through Bandcamp, you know, through YouTube,
right.
through Spotify, you know, whatever else, like
SoundCloud. Yeah. So, but live is still a big part of it, which of course leads to a lot of the problems that we're going to, we're going to talk about that came up this whole live. When you're talking about 30-year-old men and 14-year-old fans, you know, that's just a car crash waiting to happen.
Right.
So, so I know Burger Records was started in Fullerton, right? It was started by, Lee Rickard and Sean Borman. Is that, and is that the epicenter of this place? Is it the Orange County kids, or is that
happened
to be where they were?
It's largely Southern California. The burger scene was birthed in Southern California in OC. But a lot, you know, but the bands that they championed were definitely national, if not international, underground sensations. So they had really kind of had finger on the pulse of that whole scene. They you know, and when they were formed in 2000, I think it was 2009, that was kind of when this sort of bubblegum punk, surf rock, a lot of young musicians were looking back to the 70s to for their influences. You know, they were looking at like
punk
and sort of early, you know, sort of that 70s rock and roll, that the gritty sort of, so it was, it went away from kind of like the shoegaze of the 90s into like a more sort of raucous punk aesthetic. And Burger and Borman and Ricard, the two men who founded Burger, really had tapped into that. They had a band called The Makeout Party, and it was very much this of that genre. And they originally started the label basically, again, in the DIY way. They were just like, we're going to put out our own band on this label. And then they, you know, began putting out other bands, and then they became known. And anybody who was anybody wanted to be on Burger if you were in that scene.